originally written in the era of the rotary phones, end of quote. Bill C-30 will repair this. Bill C-30 is not the first attempt to update our laws. The problem is well known. As acknowledged by the interim Liberal leader, even the Liberals knew it. Their party introduced similar bills on three separate occasions. And Madam Speaker, the Liberal Party's present position on C-30 clearly proves that the Liberals are a value-free, principle-free, idea-free party that will accept and adopt whatever position they think is possible on the issue of the day. Liberals have been supporting this legislation for 10 years with weaker protection for privacy. And our government introduced similar bills twice, once in 2009 and once in 2010. To the disappointment of many, and despite the tireless efforts of people like Paul Gillespie, formerly of the Toronto Police Service, now the head of the Kids International Safety Alliance, and Roz Prober of Beyond Borders, none of these attempts resulted in the passage of these necessary amendments to the law, as these bills all died on the order paper. I am sure that many honourable members have heard Mr. Gillespie speak passionately about the emotional toll child exploitation investigations take on frontline officers. Each day, these officers are confronted by the bleak reality that thousands of children are sexually abused in graphic, unimaginable ways. The reality is that police simply don't have the tool to effectively fight these crimes. This is true not only in cases related to child pornography, but also to identity theft, online organized crime, and many internet scams and frauds. More than a decade ago, police spoke up and told the government of the day that they lacked the tools to keep up with changing technology. Here's just one example that illustrates the ongoing frustration and problems with the current system. This example comes from Kingston Police Detective Constable Stephanie Morgan. Detective Morgan received information via the internet that an individual might attempt suicide. When she approached a telecommunication service provider for help in locating the individual, she was prevented from proceeding further. She said, and I quote, "In that case, the internet service provider refused to give us that information because of the person's privacy. To this day, I don't know who the person was who sent the message. I don't know if they were in distress or if they later committed suicide. I think that would not have happened if this legislation was in place." End of quote. Let me give a second example. Honorable members may have heard of the case where, as part of a massive worldwide investigation of child pornography, Germany alerted Canadian law enforcement officials that 200 IP addresses using Canadian internet service providers were associated with online child exploitation. The RCMP requested information from these Canadian internet service providers to help them identify potential suspects. Unfortunately, the RCMP was unable to identify account holders associated with 47 specific IP addresses due to a lack of cooperation from some service providers. That means that 47 leads reach a dead end, and today, countless children remain at risk. A third example is an international criminal investigation involving 78 Canadian IP addresses linked to the purchase of child pornography. In that case, requests for customer name and address were submitted to the relevant internet service providers. But again, this basic subscriber information was not provided by all the service providers. As a result, 18 suspects have not been identified and today remain free to jeopardize the safety and security of young Canadians. These are not isolated cases. Last year alone, 62 requests for basic subscriber information made by the RCMP's National Child Exploitation Coordination Center in Ottawa were simply refused. It's simply unacceptable. And that's why on February 14th, I reintroduced legislation that closely resembles the efforts of the previous Liberal government, but with important improvements that better protect the privacy of Canadians. I might point out that this legislation has the support of all provincial and territorial attorneys general and public safety ministers. Madam Speaker, the Liberal flip-flop on this piece of legislation is simply unbelievable. Bill C-30 allows police to request six kinds of basic subscriber information to assist with the kinds of investigations that I just spoke about. But just as critically, it makes police 100% accountable through audits and obligations to report to federal and provincial privacy commissioners. Let's look at the first part of this, that relating to basic subscriber information. Basic subscriber information is essential for criminal and national security investigations, as well as for responding to non-criminal community needs such as assisting families find runaway youths. We have improved on previous versions of this legislation by reducing the number of basic subscriber information points that police could request of service providers from 11 in the Liberal legislation down to 6. This information is clearly stated: name, address, phone number, email address, internet protocol address, and local service provider identifier. Nothing more. This is the modern day equivalent of a phone book and phone book information. Bill C-30 would put in place a system of checks and balances that simply does not exist today, including officials will have to be designated to make subscriber information requests, and only a limited number of officials will be allowed to be designated to request basic subscriber information. Either 5 individuals or 5% of an agency's workforce, whichever is greater. It will be set out in the law that all basic requests for basic subscriber information will have to be made in the performance of a duty or a function of the agency in which the designated official is employed. For internal auditing purposes, officials will be required to record the purpose for which each request for basic subscriber information was made. The police, CSIS, and the Competition Bureau will conduct regular internal audits to ensure that their practices and procedures for requesting basic subscriber information comply with the legislation. And all findings of these audits, including any concerns and actions taken or proposed, will be provided either to the Minister of Public Safety or the Minister of Industry, as well as the review body responsible for that organization, such as the Privacy Commissioner. Madam Speaker, basic subscriber information does not include information pertaining to the websites an individual has visited, the content of emails, or the content of phone calls either made or received. Police will continue to obtain judicial authorization or a warrant before this type of information will be requested from service providers, as they do today. There is no change to the law in this regard. Bill C-30 creates no new powers to access the content of emails, web browsing history, or phone calls beyond that which already exists in Canadian law today. Law enforcement and national security officials will continue to rely on lawful authority before they are allowed to intercept communications. This has been the case for the last 40 years, and it will continue to be the case under Bill C-30. I emphasize this because so far there's been a great deal of misinformation spread about this component of the legislation. As I mentioned earlier, law enforcement officials today can already intercept private communications in very exceptional circumstances without first obtaining a court authorization. It simply recognizes that there are situations and some cases where action needs to be taken quickly in such cases as kidnappings or bomb threats where an immediate interception could help save lives. Furthermore, this legislation proposes to actually add robust safeguards to the laws that will increase accountability and transparency. Some have accused me of not reading a bill that I've been involved in shaping for over half a decade. Ironically, when I read most media coverage of Bill C-30, I am struck by just how poorly the bill is understood by many writers. That is why our government intends to send this legislation directly to committee for a full examination. I hope that all Canadians, and especially members of Parliament and the media, will read, discuss, and reflect on this bill. The fact is that stakeholders, victims advocacy groups, police associations, all attorneys generals, all public safety ministers in this country have asked for and support these changes, as do many ordinary Canadians. As I've said before, the proposals we are putting forward are not new or even revolutionary. The focus of Bill C-30 is not to create new interception powers. It will not compromise the privacy of Canadians or put an undue burden on businesses. What it does do is bring our country's legislation out of the Cold War era and into the 21st century, along with other Western democracies around the world. This legislation provides law enforcement and CSIS with the updated tools they need while providing maximum flexibility for industry and creating rigorous safeguards to protect privacy. It strikes an appropriate balance between the needs of law enforcement and CSIS, the competitiveness of industry, and the privacy of Canadians. We told Canadians during the last election that we would continue to crack down on crime. We've delivered on that. We told them we would address the needs of victims of terrorism by allowing them to sue perpetrators of terrorist acts and their supporters. We've delivered on that. We've done a lot. We're doing a lot. I look forward to continuing the debate on Bill C-30 both at committee and in this House. Thank you very much.
Questions or comments?
To the Minister's speech. I have a couple of questions. One is, does the Minister feel that if the RCMP were to be given more financial resources, they could be more effective in tracking down child predators? Number two, there's a difference between the bill the Minister introduced now and the one he introduced in the previous Parliament. The request is for, or the bill gives the power to obtain a more limited set of pieces of subscriber information. I'm wondering what changed the Minister's mind to reduce that number. One of the pieces of data that is now will not be covered by Section 16.1 is the IMSI number, and I'm just wondering if the Minister feels the IMSI number is similarly just like a number in a phone book, and if that's the case, why didn't he include the IMSI number under Section 16.1?
The Honourable Minister, Public Safety.
What we did in this particular bill, Madam Speaker, was take the principles and indeed almost word for word the legislation produced by the former Liberal government. And what, of course, the Deputy Prime Minister at the time, Anne McLellan, said about the bill, we consulted extensively to ensure this legislation strikes the right balance between the needs of police to maintain their investigative capabilities and the business considerations of the industry while respecting Canadians' privacy, rights, and freedoms, said the Deputy Prime Minister at the time. When I looked at the bill, I examined what issues can further strengthen the privacy rights of Canadians without compromising the ability of the police to effectively investigate. The member, and that's why we essentially landed up on the six criteria. If the member feels that that list from 11 to the six that we have settled on is somehow too restrictive, that's something that I'm willing to consider and debate. But police are telling me the six are sufficient for their purposes, and I think that fits with the overall scope of balancing the rights of investigation and the police and the privacy of ordinary Canadians.
Questions and comments? Honorable député.
The honourable member for Montmorency-Charlevoix-Haute-Côte, no. Thank you, Madam Speaker. In the NDP, we want the police to have the tools they need to deal with threats. We feel that it is possible to pursue criminals without calling Canadians who are law-abiding, without treating them as criminals. Will the government commit to suppressing from Bill C-30 everything dealing with access to personal information without a warrant?
The Honourable Minister.
As I've indicated, this bill does nothing in that respect to expand the powers of police to obtain personal information without warrant. The law simply recognizes the differences in technology and therefore attempts to update the law in terms of ensuring that technology is captured by the legislation. But in respect of the personal privacy of individuals, for example, the content of emails, the web browsing history, the content of telephone calls, that remains off limits in the same way that it does today without this law.
Questions and comments? The Honourable Member for Surrey North.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, the Minister of Public Safety pointed out that this bill is moving laws into the 21st century. I think Canadians would disagree with him that, in fact, this is moving backwards to Cold War, not only Cold War, but the communist state, the totalitarian states that we've had in the early part there. The minister correctly pointed out that they have reduced the list of identifiers from 11 to 6. However, in a sneaky way, the government has part of the bill will require, will allow the government, it basically includes a regulatory power that permits the governor in council to add even more kinds of information that can be accessed without a warrant. Section 64 of the Act covers that. Are there additional identifiers that are going to be added later on?
The Honourable Minister.
The government has no intention of adding additional identifiers. I note that the Liberal member indicated that he might want to see one or two more identifiers to be added without warrant. Certainly that's something that...
The Honourable Member on a point of order.
Asked a legitimate question about the logic behind the government's approach to this bill. I did not in any way, shape, or form suggest that there should be data added to the list of six, and I think it's very wrong for the minister to try and spin it that way. I really think he misrepresented